Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Retirement Reboot, Commonsense Financial Strategies for Getting Back on Track, by Mark Miller, narrated by Adam Barr. It's one of the great secret scandals of our country that people don't realize they can work a lifetime and still not have enough money for retirement. The late Karen Ferguson, Executive Director, Pension Rights Center, 2002. Foreword. I've been a fan of Mark Miller's columns on the personal finances of aging and retirement in the New York Times, Reuters, Morningstar, and other publications for a long time. He's a deft writer and thoughtful storyteller with a knack for getting to the nub of the issue. He's delved deep into his journalistic experience to address the vital and timely topic of how the financially unprepared can improve their economic security and quality of life in retirement. The financially fragile, by the way, is most of us. Popular images of the retirement years typically draw playful images of time on the beach, traveling to far-flung places, and checking off bucket list adventures. The reality, as both private sector surveys and government data support, is that a majority of near retirees aren't financially ready for the next stage of life. That realization is sobering, but it isn't a message of despair. The financially unprepared have time to boost the odds of creating greater economic security later in life. In Retirement Reboot, Commonsense Financial Strategies for Getting Back on Track, Mark takes a roll-up-the-sleeves approach and offers financially fragile near retirees practical options and plans. He cuts through the many layers of complexity about retirement planning to get to the heart of sensible trade-offs and reasonable choices. With good reason, keep it simple is a valuable catchphrase in household money management. Retirement is a major life transition. Here are just a few decisions near retirees confront. When to retire. Whether to embrace part-time work, an encore career, or leisure. Whether to age at home or move elsewhere. How much to withdraw annually from retirement savings, assuming you have some. And, most importantly, when to claim Social Security benefits and what kind of Medicare plan to join. That's far from an exhaustive list. The good news is that some combination of the tactics Mark explains will help with these decisions. The hallmark of Retirement Reboot, its defining feature, is the emphasis he puts on understanding Social Security and Medicare. Too often, these two bedrock programs are treated as a personal finance afterthought. Big mistake. The truly critical retirement decisions for most workers are deciding when to file for Social Security benefits and which Medicare plan to enroll in. Everything else pales in comparison, except for the sliver of extremely wealthy. Look at it this way. About half the U.S. population aged 65 or older are in households that receive at least half their income from Social Security, while 25% rely on Social Security for 90% of their income. Here's what makes the timing of filing for Social Security income so important. The benefit is potentially 76% higher if you wait to file at age 70, the latest claiming age, compared to age 62, the earliest. Every year you delay past your full retirement age, you'll get an approximately 8% boost. The full retirement age for most people is currently 66 years plus several months. Married couples in particular have a number of filing strategies to consider for maximizing their earned benefit. What matters is that you make an informed choice. Hard to believe, but Medicare is even more complicated. Medicare provides universal health insurance for people aged 65 or older. The key decision is whether to go with traditional fee-for-service Medicare or the managed care Medicare Advantage. If you pick traditional Medicare over Medicare Advantage, you'll also need to decide on the best supplemental coverage or Medigap policy to protect yourself from potentially high out-of-pocket costs. Again, Mark is a trustworthy guide to your choices. I want to echo Mark's call, no, make that shout, for all of us to exercise our voices and our votes to make America's social contract between the generations, Social Security and Medicare, even more generous and comprehensive, while ensuring that both programs are financially stable. The quality of the future retirement of the younger generations who will eventually find themselves at retirement age is at stake. The development of modern retirement is among the great economic and social achievements of the 20th century. Before Social Security, 1935, and Medicare and Medicaid, 1965, a majority of elderly Americans fell into poverty after they stopped working. These two programs are the foundations of economic security in retirement. They're also concrete expressions of two powerful yet abstract ideas, the common good and intergenerational equity. Social Security is a trust based on broadly shared civic and religiously based principles. Concern for our parents, for our neighbors, for our children, and for the legacy we will leave for our children and those who follow, writes Nancy Altman, co-director of the nonprofit organization Social Security Works. What Altman says about Social Security holds for Medicare. Social Security and Medicare have always been important, but their stabilizing role is increasingly critical because financial insecurity among older Americans is on the rise. America's retirement system is currently a mess, a technical economic term. System, as Mark notes, is too grand a word for the ad hoc retirement financial edifice that currently exists. To be sure, the current structure works reasonably well for those on the payroll of an employer with a retirement benefit plan and relatively stable jobs. Long-term employees at larger companies typically have 401ks with automatic enrollment, automatic contribution increases, employer matching contributions, and well-diversified portfolios. The odds that they'll maintain their standard of living in their elder years are high. But for most people, the so-called system is opaque, difficult to navigate, and fails too many workers in providing economic security in retirement. The core problem is that the kind of institutional arrangements that once shared risks among participants in society have given way to programs that shift the burden of risk management toward individuals. A classic example is traditional pensions being replaced by 401ks. The financial risks associated with long lives are too much for most people, especially considering how major economic upheavals can damage household finances. Here's an incomplete list drawn from the past quarter century. Two major recessions in the first decade of this century, the tragedy of 9/11, wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, the global credit crunch and Great Recession, the pandemic and lockdown economy, higher inflation during the rebound from the pandemic, and the economic disturbances ignited by Russia's tragic invasion of Ukraine. The social compact between the generations should be expanded in the 21st century. Most important is for society to embrace a universal, risk-sharing, long-term care benefit. The demand for long-term care is growing with the aging of the population. Long-term care is expensive, and the costs are unevenly distributed throughout society. Most older adults don't have sufficient savings to pay the potential tab. Their families, the so-called informal care system, usually step in and provide the bulk of care. The formal care system is a frayed patchwork quilt of programs, including nursing homes and paid home care. Medicare provides coverage only for a limited time. The private long-term care insurance market is a minor player. Mark's chapter on managing long-term care risk is the best I've read on how to navigate existing options. We also badly need a way to offer every worker a means to save for retirement. For example, the government could enroll every worker in an IRA or 401k-type plan through automatic payroll deduction. Another universal savings option would put everyone working for an employer that does not offer a retirement savings plan into the federal government's giant, low-cost, thrift savings plan. The bottom line is, it's relatively simple and long past time to offer all private sector employees access to a retirement plan at work. All Americans would benefit from fully funded and well-thought-out universal risk-sharing programs for their retirement years, especially younger people who will retire decades from now. Perhaps the greatest opportunity of the 21st century is to envision and create a society that nurtures longer lives, not only for the sake of the older generation, but also for the benefit of all age groups, what I call the third demographic dividend, writes Linda Fried, Dean of the Millman School of Public Health at Columbia University. To get there requires a collective grand act of imagination to create a vision for the potential of longer lives. Fried is spot on. In the meantime, a majority of Americans need help to improve the odds that they'll maintain their standard of living in their elder years. This is the book for them. A practical, thoughtful guide for building income security and purpose, despite hard times. Chris Farrell, Senior Economics Contributor, Marketplace, and Minnesota Public Radio. Introduction. If you are getting close to retirement, the odds are pretty good that you're not prepared. I don't mean getting prepared emotionally, although retirement is a significant life transition that can shake people up. I'm talking about the financial side of retirement. And the statistics tell us that two-thirds or more of Americans nearing retirement age simply are not ready. The most important measure of financial readiness to retire is your ability to replace working income after you retire. In other words, your ability to maintain your standard of living. This readiness is directly related, of course, to the financial history of your working years, career earnings, time spent out of the workforce, and financial emergencies that flare up along the way. Competing demands for each available dollar, such as the high cost of housing, childcare, and college tuition, also matter a great deal to your level of preparation for retirement. An unexpected crisis or life upheaval, like a health emergency, divorce, or disability that prevents you from working, can throw your plans off track. Americans approaching retirement now have surfed some especially scary economic waves. If you were 55 years old in 2021, you've experienced four recessions that might have left you unemployed for extended periods of time. Two of them were especially devastating for older workers, the Great Recession of 2009 to 2010 and the pandemic-induced recession that began in 2020. Both of these downturns produced higher rates of job loss and longer periods of joblessness for older workers than for younger ones. Millions of homeowners lost their homes or found themselves deep underwater in the housing crash accompanying the Great Recession. We tend to have short memories in this country, but these economic calamities had long-lasting effects that were very difficult, if not impossible, to recover from. Even a short-term interruption in wages can have a surprisingly large impact on retirement. Each year out of the workforce translates into losses considerably larger than the immediate amount of missing salary. These losses compound over the arc of a career, lost wage growth and retirement savings, and credits towards Social Security and pension benefits. If you've been saving and investing for retirement, and that's a big if, you have lived and worked through 8 stock market crashes or bear markets, 9 if you're a few years older and experienced the Black Monday crash of 1987. You struggled with competing demands for dollars that might have been saved. For example, over the past 2 decades, average annual tuition and fees at private universities jumped 144%. In-state costs at public schools soared 212%. Nearly 10 million retirement-age households spend more than 30% of their income on housing, meaning that they fall into the category researchers call cost-burdened. The share of older households carrying debt has soared over the past 2 decades, and bankruptcy rates are rising. Roughly 1/4 of adults say they or a household member have had problems paying medical bills, and about half have put off or skipped health care or dental care in a typical year. Perhaps you needed to quit your job to provide care for someone you love. 1 out of every 5 Americans are caregivers for an adult or child with special needs. Meanwhile, Wages have been growing slowly for most workers over the past four decades, and nearly all the wage growth that did occur was concentrated among the highest income households. In fact, if we had not experienced wage growth during periods of very low unemployment in the late 1990s and just before the pandemic, real wages would be lower today than they were 40 years ago. Many Americans are living with no financial reserves whatsoever. Nearly 40% of adults say they could not cover a $400 emergency with cash, savings, or a credit card charge. The COVID-19 pandemic has stretched the financial rubber band even tighter for millions, in many cases, past the breaking point. The percentage of these at-risk households already was very high pre-pandemic across income groups, and it has jumped substantially since the coronavirus struck. Risk is highest for low-income households, but nearly as high for middle earners. People of color face substantially higher risks, the result of our history of racism in the labor market, evident in everything from hiring to pay, promotions, and benefits. These inequities have kept incomes much lower than for white counterparts. And numerous policies have served as barriers to wealth accumulation by black people. These include the Jim Crow era black codes, which restricted opportunity in many southern states, racially restrictive covenants that barred them from buying homes in white neighborhoods, and redlining practices that made mortgages hard or impossible to obtain. The inequities have compounded over time as families were unable to transfer wealth to subsequent generations. A majority of single black and Latino retirees don't have sufficient incomes to meet the basic cost of living, and women also face special risks. They tend to earn less than men, and they are more likely to take time off from work to care for children or elderly parents. Even brief career interruptions diminish wage growth, retirement savings, and Social Security benefits, which are determined by wage history. Women also tend to outlive men, needing to stretch resources over more years. In particular, they face higher health care expenses in retirement. Taken together, we can see that many older Americans will have trouble maintaining their standard of living in retirement. One of the best measures of this risk is the Elder Index, produced by the Gerontology Institute at the University of Massachusetts, Boston. It measures the cost of living for older people living as couples or alone, but independent of children. It is built around the typical budgets of seniors, and it shows that roughly half of Americans over age 65 living alone have incomes that are below the index. In other words, they lack the resources to pay for their basic living needs. For couples who usually benefit from two Social Security checks and are more likely to have other income, the comparable figure is 23%. But the figures are far worse for people of color and for women living alone. If you're not ready for retirement for any of the reasons I've described, and it's probably more than one, this book is for you. Not because I have some magic formula to offer. I don't. What I do have to offer is a short list of practical strategies that can improve your financial security in retirement. They are not necessarily easy, but they are achievable, sensible steps, and you still have time to take them. These are the strategies that I've distilled from 15 years working as a journalist covering the retirement and aging beat. One of the best things about being a journalist is access. You can sit down with experts and get them to explain things to you and to teach you things. And as a student of retirement, I have taken full advantage, interviewing many of the top experts in the field here in the United States and around the world. I estimate that I've produced nearly 1,000 articles and podcasts about retirement and conducted well over 3,300 interviews. I've read hundreds of research papers on everything from Social Security, Medicare, and other types of health insurance to late career work, investing and saving, workplace retirement plans, pensions, taxes, financial planning, housing, careers, long-term care, and caregiving. Here's the most important thing I've learned. Complexity is the enemy of everyday working Americans trying to build toward a financially secure retirement. The United States has built a set of systems for retirement that call for expertise and knowledge beyond what is reasonable to expect from the average person. The complexity of these systems makes it harder for individuals to make fundamental personal decisions about their own retirement planning, how to save and invest for retirement, how to stay employed later in life, figuring out the right time to retire, when to file for Social Security, how to transition from employer health insurance to Medicare, what to do about long-term care insurance, how to hire a trustworthy financial planner. Even the experts tell me that they have trouble with these questions themselves or when they try to provide guidance for friends and family. Consider my favorite example of unnecessary complexity, Medicare. When you first sign up for Medicare, it's very possible to make choices that can be either a good or bad fit for your needs. Probably the biggest mistake you can make is failing to sign up for Medicare at the right time. This can lead to costly late enrollment penalties on the premiums you pay and risky, potentially large, gaps in your insurance coverage. You also need to make a consequential decision at the initial point of enrollment that can be difficult to undo. Whether to enroll in traditional fee-for-service Medicare or Medicare Advantage, the managed care commercial offering that can be substituted for traditional Medicare. Advantage can save you money on the front end because you won't be paying for separate Medigap supplemental coverage, and you might not need a separate prescription drug plan. But you will face managed care networks that limit your choice of providers. Advantage plans will also make you jump through prior authorization hoops for some procedures and treatments, and they are known for high rates of denial of care. Complexity has a couple of side effects. Research on the psychology of choice shows that too much choice produces paralysis. Confronted with too many options, we simply freeze. And even when we do manage to make choices, we're less satisfied with what we've picked because we imagine alternatives that might have been better. Medicare's own data shows that more than half of enrollees don't review or compare their coverage options annually to ensure that their coverage is still a good fit, including 46% who never or rarely revisited their plans. Two-thirds of beneficiaries 85 years or older don't review their coverage annually, and up to 33% of this age group say they never do. People in poor health or with low income or education levels are also much less likely to shop. The complexity dilemma can be found throughout the U.S. retirement system. For millions of workers, traditional defined benefit pensions have been replaced by 401k or individual retirement accounts, IRAs. Pension plans are administered by financial professionals, and workers don't have to do much beyond do their jobs and earn benefit credits along the way. At retirement, a check starts to arrive and doesn't stop until you pass away. If you own a 401k or IRA, you're completely in charge, and making good decisions can be difficult. How much do you need to contribute to build a substantial retirement nest egg? What investment choices should you make? What fees are you paying on your investments, and are they excessive? Should you use only tax-deferred accounts, or would a Roth IRA, where taxes are paid up front, be better for you? Should you leave your 401k with your employer when you retire, or move the account elsewhere? How much can you withdraw sustainably from your savings on a monthly or annual basis? Bill Bernstein, an investing expert, author, and neurologist, once quipped, "The current system is like getting onto the airplane and instead of turning right after you get into the door and going to your seat, you're told, no, you're going to turn left and go into the pilot seat and fly the plane to Los Angeles. And that's not too extreme of an analogy because I've known airline pilots who couldn't invest their way out of a paper bag. Investing is not easy, and to expect the average person to run their own retirement portfolio, I think, is patently absurd." We all face the risk of a large long-term care expense during retirement due to disability, poor health, or cognitive decline. But the actual risk is impossible to gauge, and our current retirement system leaves us at the mercy of complex, poorly working solutions to pay for care. Few actually take action to protect themselves. And who can blame them? Commercial long-term care insurance policies are expensive and hard to understand, and they leave buyers exposed to escalating premiums over time. And people are understandably reluctant to spend thousands of dollars annually on insurance premiums for a long-term care need that might come far down the road or not at all. Only the most affluent households can afford to pay out of pocket, and just about everyone else will be covered under Medicaid, which funds care only in cases where a patient's assets have been almost completely spent. The roadmap of this book. In the chapters ahead, I offer practical strategies for getting ready for retirement, even at a late date. Each chapter will describe action steps you can take, but I'll also offer background and context throughout on how our retirement system became what it is today. I've organized the book around six core ideas that can be leveraged to improve retirement outcomes. Making a plan. If you don't have a plan, it's impossible to know whether you are on track to meet your goals. And the key goal in retirement is simple: replace enough income from your working years to live comfortably. Social Security will probably replace no more than half of your pre-retirement income. Savings or income from a pension might help close the gap, but if those aren't options, you have a few other levers to pull that can help balance income and living costs. Timing your retirement. Income from work is one of the most critical components of your retirement plan, especially in the last decade of your career. It's a time when most people enjoy career-high earnings, so the timing of retirement is a major financial inflection point. Working even a few years more, or less, will impact your financial security in retirement significantly. Optimizing Social Security. For most Americans, Social Security will be the single most important retirement benefit, full stop. So it's worth taking the time to understand how benefits work and decisions you can make that may boost your Social Security benefits substantially. Navigating Medicare. Healthcare is one of the most significant expenses in retirement, and making smart choices about your Medicare enrollment can help you manage these costs. Unfortunately, the Medicare enrollment process is complex. In this chapter, we'll break down the most important decisions, the pluses and minuses of the different Medicare choices you can make, pitfalls to avoid, and where you can get help with the process. Building savings. Starting as early as possible is the name of the game when it comes to saving for retirement. But if you're getting close to retirement and haven't been able to save much, don't despair. It is still possible to build significant savings late in the game. We'll consider a simple, low-cost approach to saving for retirement that can help you play catch-up. Tapping home equity. If you own a home, it's one of your most important assets, so managing it smartly can pay dividends in retirement. This chapter considers strategies for tapping home equity, including downsizing and reverse mortgages. From there, we'll move on to some additional strategies that can also improve your odds of a successful, happy retirement. Managing your career to the finish line. The job prospects of older workers were not great before the COVID-19 recession, and the crisis has added considerable uncertainty. For older people still willing and able to work, it's time to get creative. It will be necessary to redefine the type of work you do, where you do it, and what constitutes acceptable pay. Aging in place. Deciding where to live in retirement can be a big challenge. You're attempting to make decisions now to fit your future lifestyle and health. A decline in health, the death of a spouse, or a changing financial situation are all things we should be considering, even if it's not easy to do. And finding age-appropriate housing that is affordable can be a major challenge. Managing long-term care risk. Most of us will slow down as we get older. You might be very active, independent, and engaged in your 60s or beyond, but at some point that independence starts to shift to dependence, at least to some degree. Will you need help with your daily living needs? Probably, but the intensity and duration of need are impossible to predict. Who will you depend on for support? Will it be a family member, or will you rely on paid professional help? How will you pay for care? The value of advice. You might think that financial advisors only work for rich people, but financial planning help has become far more accessible to people with more modest assets, and it has become far more professional and holistic in approach. A wide array of solid help is available these days, and you should take advantage. Taxes in retirement. If you're one of those people who dread tax day every year, here's some good news. Your tax burden will probably lighten when you retire. And you may be able to take advantage of some strategies to smooth out or minimize your tax burden. Managing your pension. Most people think traditional pensions are a thing of the past. In fact, most state and local government workers still have traditional defined benefit pensions, and 15% of private sector workers have them. For those lucky enough to expect a pension, this chapter explains how to monitor and manage it, how benefit formulas work, and how to think through lump sum and buyout offers. Becoming an entrepreneur after age 50. Considering the risks of staying employed after age 50, going into business for yourself can be a very viable way to keep working and improve your retirement security. The stereotypical image of an entrepreneur in the United States may be a 20-something who starts a business in a garage. But older people actually are far more likely to start businesses, and their success rates are higher. Very often, these are sole proprietor businesses launched without much capital at all. Finding your purpose in retirement. Whether you work as a volunteer or part-time for pay, there's plenty of evidence that having a commitment to goals that are meaningful to you and that contribute to the common good is an essential part of a fulfilling retirement. You can find purpose in projects related to your family, work, social and political causes, faith, or other types of life missions. It's only important that the issue matters to you, whether it is global in nature or right around the corner in your community. Toward a new social insurance era. When I hear from readers who are worried about the future of Social Security or Medicare, their questions and comments often take a passive tone. What will happen to me if they cut my benefits? Or what happens if they allow the Social Security trust funds to become insolvent? But this is a book about action steps you can take to improve your personal retirement outlook. Social Security and Medicare have both played critical roles in improving the lives of millions of Americans. But as has happened throughout their history, these programs need to change and do more. Or, better put, we need to advocate for changes in these programs so that they can serve us better. I wrap up the book with an argument for a new era of social insurance in the United States. If you've reached the point where retirement is approaching fast and you don't feel ready, that's no surprise. You've been facing economic headwinds, complex, problematic retirement systems, and a blizzard of low-quality information. But it's not too late to make some moves that can improve life for your future retired self. Let's get to work. Chapter 1. Making a Plan. If you don't have a financial plan for retirement, it's impossible to know where you stand. And the goal is clear. Arrive at retirement able to replace enough of the income you earned during your working years to live comfortably. You might have some secondary goals, too. Perhaps travel, entertainment, spoiling your grandchildren, or leaving a financial legacy for your family. But job one is to be able to maintain your standard of living, not just on the day you retire, but over what might be a chapter of your life that could last several decades. Social Security will replace about 54% of pre-retirement income for a low-income worker who retires earning $25,000 per year. That figure falls to 40% for people who retire with income in the $50,000 per year range, and someone who retires earning $90,000 would be able to replace just 33%. Two-income households will beat those replacement rates, since two benefit checks will arrive each month. Savings or income from a pension might help close the gap. But if those aren't options, you have a few other levers to pull that can help balance income and living expenses. Making a plan for retirement is not about precision and certainty. Far too many variables and unpredictable developments can crop up along the way. But taking the time to estimate your likely expenses and income in retirement will get you beyond guesswork. And even more important, a plan gives you a context for decision-making. Do you need to cut spending and boost savings? Should you try to work a few extra years to close a projected income gap? If you haven't done the homework, you can't know where you're headed. In this chapter, we'll consider how much you'll need to live and how to project income and the major variables and unknowns that might affect the plan you make. What constitutes success or failure? You'll find plenty of talk in the personal finance press about retirement plans that succeed or fail. Usually, those terms refer to whether your savings last throughout your retirement, and certainly savings are an important element of retirement. But the most important yardstick of success or failure is loss of standard of living. That's why it's important to think about the big picture, not just savings, but income from guaranteed sources such as Social Security. And importantly, you need to consider what you'll need to spend. How much will you need? A widely used rule of thumb promoted by the financial services industry is that workers will need 70% to 80% of their pre-retirement income in retirement to maintain their standard of living. That's a convenient motivator aimed at getting people to sock more money into their mutual fund accounts with these firms. But for most people, it's a very difficult hurdle to clear, considering the baseline provided by Social Security. What's more, the rule of thumb is far too general. It might be right for you, and it might not. Here's why. Your spending likely will vary over time. One researcher examined federal data on actual spending patterns and found that the needed replacement rate varies from 54% to 87% of income, and that spending actually falls over the course of retirement. The pattern is most pronounced for the oldest old, a time when interest and ability to spend on travel, entertainment, and clothes tend to fall. This is especially true for more affluent households, which typically have more discretionary pre-retirement spending and thus have more flexibility in retirement to cut back if funds aren't available. For example, for households spending $100,000 a year in retirement, annual outlays fell 30% by the end of a 30-year retirement. But the declines were substantial for lower-income households, too. Spending by a household with an initial retirement spending target of $25,000 a year fell 8%, and the figure was 20% for a household spending $50,000. Not all spending is equal. Some expenses are necessary. Think housing, food, healthcare, utilities, and transportation. Some are discretionary, dining out, traveling, and entertainment. You can bend the curve. If your expected spending and income don't look balanced, remember that it is possible to make changes. If retirement is in view for you over the next 10 years, it may be possible to boost income somewhat, but your best opportunities will be found on the expense side of the ledger. For example, by downsizing your home, reducing the number of cars you drive, or getting rid of high-cost monthly bills, think cable TV or high mobile phone bills. How to make a plan. I'll walk you through the basics in the rest of this chapter. You can do this analysis yourself, but the other path is to get some professional advice. Many people think financial advisors are for only the wealthy, but there are plenty of reasonably priced options that can pay for themselves and then some in the form of an improved retirement outcome. We'll take a closer look at working with advisors in Chapter 10. Here are three basic questions you should try to answer as you sketch out your plan. What are you spending now? Start by analyzing what you spend now. You'll want to break this into three categories. Fixed expenses. These include items that don't change or change infrequently. For example, your home mortgage or rent, taxes, insurance, debt repayments, and subscriptions. Variable expenses. This category includes groceries, utilities, clothing, home maintenance, and gasoline. Discretionary. This includes entertainment, travel, recreation, and charitable contributions. Analyze one full year of expenses so that you can capture seasonal variations, and try to use a year that was typical for you, not one with one-time large expenses or years where discretionary spending was unusually low. You can do this on paper or a spreadsheet, but also consider one of the online tools that automate the process by connecting to your checking, savings, and credit card accounts. Mint and Personal Capital are solid choices that make it easy to track spending by aggregating all of your accounts in one spot and automatically updating data. Both services allow you to easily categorize spending and run reports to see where your spending is going. How might your spending change in retirement? Some types of expenditures will disappear entirely or change dramatically. For example, you might be contributing now to a retirement savings plan. You certainly are expending part of your income on federal, state, and perhaps local income taxes, and taxes you pay for Social Security and Medicare via the Federal Insurance Contributions Act, FICA, and health insurance premiums. You won't need to spend money on clothes for work or lunches out. Some areas of spending will rise. For example, healthcare costs will likely be higher since older people use more healthcare. Your health insurance costs also may be higher after you transition from employer-based insurance to Medicare. That's because your employer picks up a hefty share of the overall plan cost. Income. Of course, income in retirement is the other side of the equation. We will consider how to estimate, plan, and boost retirement income in the chapters ahead, but for now, you'll want to have these possible sources of income on your radar screen. Social Security. For most Americans, this will be the most important source of income. In Chapter 3, we'll consider how your benefit is calculated and how to make the best decisions for optimizing it. Savings. Even if you haven't saved much, it may be possible to build a significant nest egg even with a late start. We'll explore how in Chapter 5. Traditional pension. If you are fortunate enough to have a defined benefit pension, it will be just as important as Social Security and perhaps more so. A pension remains one of the most automatic and reliable retirement benefits around, and it can be a critical income source in retirement. In Chapter 12, we'll take a detailed dive into how pensions work and how to make good decisions about yours. Home equity. Most older Americans are homeowners, and many have more home equity than financial assets. Home equity can be tapped as a resource for income in retirement, and we'll explore the options in Chapter 6. Retirement risks. No matter how well you plan, some very important factors will influence the outcome. As Yogi Berra is alleged to have said, it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future. Making a plan for retirement does give you a roadmap of what might occur and some important tools that can help you make decisions. But it's important to understand that many difficult-to-predict risk factors could force you to make revisions to your plan along the way. Most of us don't perceive these risks objectively. A study of major retirement risks and how people perceive them found a disconnect between perception and the quantifiable risk people actually experience over the course of retirement. The study considers the following major risks: longevity, the risk that you will outlive your financial resources; healthcare, the risk of rapidly rising costs of routine and long-term care; market risk, the risk associated with the shift from traditional pensions to 401ks, which leaves retirees with greater responsibility to manage investments and suffer direct losses when markets head south; inflation. Fast rising consumer prices jumped back into the headlines in 2021 and 2022 for the first time in several decades, as the global economy reeled from the pandemic, unstable energy markets, and the war in Ukraine. But inflation is a constant risk factor in your retirement plan, even when it's not making headlines, and it can cut into purchasing power in retirement substantially. Compounded inflation rates from 1900 to 2015 averaged 3.15%, but there were four periods where inflation was significantly higher than the average. Even average rates of inflation can take a large toll. Two decades of average inflation at 3% would cut your purchasing power in half. True inflation protection is difficult to find without taking questionable investment risks, with one major exception, Social Security. Your benefits come with an automatic annual cost of living adjustment. Beyond that, it's worth running some what-if analysis in your plan that considers various levels of inflation across your future years of retirement. Family, an unforeseen need to provide help to family members. Policy, the risk that the federal government will fail to continue fully funding Social Security or Medicare. The researchers found that most people think their largest risk is in the stock market. But the most important is your longevity, how many years of retirement you'll ultimately fund. Planners call this longevity risk, the danger of exhausting resources before the end of life. And risk actually is higher for wealthier people since they tend to rely less on Social Security, which provides a guaranteed lifetime source of income, and more on savings, which can be exhausted at advanced ages. Risk also rises for widows who reach advanced ages, since total household Social Security income falls when one spouse dies, typically by about one-third. Some expenses fall, but poverty rates tend to rise in these situations. Longevity has been rising. The expected lifespan for men and women at age 65 has jumped more than 10% since 2000, according to the Society of Actuaries. Men who reach age 65 can be expected to live to an average age of 86.6, and women to 88.8. Those figures are only averages. One researcher, working with Social Security Administration data, calculated that a 65-year-old man has a 20% chance to live to 90, and the odds jump to 30% if he is in better-than-average health. Meanwhile, 31% of women who reach age 65 will make it to 90. And for those with better health, the figure is 42%. Another important unknown is how long you'll stay employed. The timing of retirement is one of the most important factors influencing retirement security, as we'll hear in the next chapter, but it's also difficult to predict. Half of retirees retire earlier than planned. Older workers often find themselves the victim of age discrimination, and the pandemic added a new element of risk. At least 1.7 million more older workers than expected retired during the pandemic recession of 2020, hitting people with lower incomes and people of color hardest. Other reasons for premature retirement include a health problem you might have to cope with for yourself or a loved one, or just plain burnout. The pool of leisure activities or time spent with family could be factors too. It's true that more older people have been working longer in recent years, but that trend has been concentrated mostly among more educated, high-income households. Even worse, there is a gap between expectations and reality. Surveys often reveal that the retirement plan among people without adequate resources is to just work forever. But that approach actually creates a special type of financial risk. One study found that assuming you'll be able to work to an advanced age can work against you if retirement comes sooner than you hoped and savings fall short. And the report concludes that the more ambitious your plan, the less likely it is to succeed. For example, people who plan to retire at age 69 likely will retire at age 65. This means that you're less likely to meet any income goals you might have set that were predicated on a later retirement date. Let's say you build a plan with very high odds of success if you work until your late 60s. In reality, the researchers found, you might really have just a 60% chance of meeting your goals. So working longer is a good aspiration if that's what you want to do. But as a retirement plan, it's shaky. Plan for cognitive decline. A growing body of evidence points to the unpleasant fact that our ability to manage our finances declines with age. That's not to say we'll all suffer from dementia, but even normal aging reduces the ability to make optimal financial choices, even though our confidence in our own financial decision-making remains high well into old age. Our level of preparation for this is not good. Only a quarter of adults have appointed an agent under power of attorney. 14% have made only informal plans for someone to act on their behalf, and nearly half, 46%, have made no arrangements at all. Consider this type of planning as a form of insurance. The problem might occur and it might not, but if it does, you're ready. The goal is to put strategies in place to protect your finances while you are still healthy and have strong cognitive ability. One of the most important steps is to identify someone who can assist with day-to-day finances, everything from paying the bills, managing your household, and monitoring financial accounts. This extra help reduces the risk of both scam victimization and routine financial missteps, such as failing to pay an important utility or insurance bill. The payoff comes in avoiding financial missteps and by creating peace of mind for you and your family. Resources. A variety of online tools and programs can help do-it-yourselfers with making a retirement plan. Here are links to several that I like. Also, listen to Chapter 10, The Value of Advice, for an argument in favor of professional help. AARP. The country's largest organization for seniors offers a budgeting tool that can help you get an accurate picture of current household expenses. aarp.org/money/budgeting-saving/home_budget_calculator.html. New retirement. Silicon Valley executive Steve Chen created a comprehensive, inexpensive suite of retirement planning tools when he tried to create a plan for his own mom and couldn't find anything he liked. Members also have access to in-depth articles on planning and join a community of other do-it-yourselfers who love to compare notes and ideas with one another. NewRetirement.com. Vanguard. Check out this simple tool for projecting retirement income, taking into account savings, Social Security, and pensions. investor.vanguard.com/calculator-tools/retirement-income-calculator. U.S. Department of Labor. The Employee Benefit Security Administration has a detailed planning tool that analyzes assets, savings, and expenses before and after retirement. Ask EBSA, that's askebsa.dol.gov/retirement-calculator/UI/general.aspx. Calculate your longevity. You can find plenty of longevity projection calculators online, but most are questionable because they use dubious health factors to project lifespans. One that I do like was created by the American Academy of Actuaries, which relies only on inputs proven to be accurate predictors, and it's simple to use. The calculator considers your age, gender, whether you smoke, and your own assessment of your general health. The resulting numbers show a range of possibilities. LongevityIllustrator.org. Cognitive Decline Roadmap. The Thinking Ahead Roadmap, a guide for keeping your money safe as you age, is an educational and decision-making resource aimed at helping people make a plan to guard against financial risks associated with cognitive decline, created by the Stanford Center on Longevity and the University of Minnesota. ThinkingAheadRoadmap.org. Chapter 2, Timing Your Retirement. Timing is everything, and retirement is no exception. The timing of your retirement determines the number of years that you will rely on savings to meet living expenses. It determines the number of years that you will be able to contribute to retirement saving accounts. The last decade of work typically is the time when you'll have career-high earnings, enabling you to save more money. And perhaps most important, working longer helps set the stage for boosting Social Security income by delaying your claim of benefits. Timing may be outside of your control. Setting a retirement target date and sticking to it is very difficult for many people, and it became even more difficult during the pandemic. But the end of work isn't always a black-and-white transition. Researchers have found that retirement is sometimes phased in gradually. For some, there will be bridge jobs between full-time work and retirement. We'll explore these ideas further in Chapter 7, Managing Your Career to the Finish Line, and Chapter 13, Becoming an Entrepreneur After 50. Among married couples, it's rare for both spouses to retire simultaneously. For a majority of couples, there is a phase where one spouse works longer than the other. That can insulate couples from post-retirement financial shocks, such as an emergency health problem or a large home repair. Continued income can also enable one or both spouses to delay their Social Security claiming. In some situations, staggered retirement enables both spouses to stay on employer-subsidized health insurance, reducing premium and out-of-pocket costs. That can be especially meaningful if one spouse is no longer working but has not yet reached the age of Medicare eligibility, 65. Decisions about how long to work are highly personal. As we age, time becomes a more limited commodity, and deciding how to use it is wrapped up in much more than your financial situation. As you'll hear throughout this book, you can pull any number of levers to improve retirement security. Working longer is an important lever to consider, but it's not the only one available to you. Demonstrating the impact. Let's illustrate the sensitivity of retirement timing with some hypothetical scenarios for people in different life situations. We're going to examine four scenarios for people who might retire at different ages. Bob is a single man, aged 62, with modest income.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.